Hey guys, this is God of Politics. I'm about to be a brand new video, but before we get started with this video, please like this video and subscribe to the channel. Also, join the Discord that is linked down in the description and check out the website, which is also linked down in the description. But in today's video, I do want to do my updated Senate battleground map. Today's date is October 16th. We are now 18 days from the election, and I will be doing my updated Senate battleground map. What is the state of the race right now? Are Democrats in a position to take back the House? Are Republicans in a position to keep the Senate? So we'll be going through each of these seats, seeing how I think they are going to go as of now. First, the safe Republican states, as always, that includes Idaho, as well as Wyoming, South Dakota, Nebraska, as well as the state of Arkansas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Tennessee, Kentucky, West Virginia. And that is going to be all the safe states for the Republican Party. That adds up to 41 safe seats. And then for the Democrats, they do have Oregon as well as New Mexico. Actually, for the Republicans, I forgot Oklahoma. So that's 42 safe seats for the Republicans. Democrats have Oregon, New Mexico, as well as Illinois, as well as Delaware, New Jersey, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, and New Hampshire, as well as Virginia. So that is 44 safe seats to the Democrats, and then 42 safe seats to the Republicans. Now, the likely margin states first. I do believe Texas is a likely margin state. MJ Hagar is the Democratic candidate. She's not Beto O'Rourke. She doesn't have the same kind of fundraising numbers. She doesn't have the same kind of enthusiasm. She's not running in a blue wave year. But, you know, Texas is still a changing state, and John Cornyn won by, over 20% last time, so his race will be a lot closer than last time, but John Cornyn will still be able to win by around 9 percentage points, I do believe. Kansas is another state that I do expect to be going by a likely margin. You have Barbara Bollier here, who is a state senator and a physician for the Democratic Party, and then for the Republican Party, you have Roger Marshall, who is a House of Representatives member from Kansas, and, Roger Marshall will win quite easily. If it was Chris Kobach, it could have been a different story, but Roger Marshall on the primary. And then the polls, some polls have shown it like Bollier winning by 2 points, and then some polls have shown Marshall winning by, 15 points. So I think, Marshall will win by around 9 to 10 percentage points. This is on the cusp of being safe, but as of now, I do think it is a likely margin state. Alaska is also a likely margin state. I would have put this a little closer, but we had the New York Times poll that came out today showing that Al Gross was down 8 percentage points. But something to note about Alaska is a very weird state. It's elected independent members, it's elected Democrats and Republicans. The majority of people in Alaska are independent, and Al Gross is an independent candidate running against a Republican. He's got good fundraising numbers. He's done, very well in the polls, aside from the New York Times poll, which has shown it a likely margin. So, maybe it could be a little bit closer than this, but I think it'll definitely be closer, considering the fact that this is Alaska. It's a pretty solidly Republican state. South Carolina, I also do believe, will be a likely Republican state. I had this lean for maybe a couple days, but then I realized, Lindsey Graham is not going to have any trouble winning his seat. Jamie Harrison, sure, he's a good candidate. He's got a lot of fundraising. He's done well in his own internal polls, but that's pretty much it. We had a New York Times poll that came out saying Jamie Harrison was down 6 percentage points. And he's got so much money, he doesn't even know what to do with all the money. South Carolina is a pretty inelastic state in the sense that you've got the black voters in South Carolina, which make a pretty sizable chunk of the electorate. Democrats have to gain amongst white voters, which is very hard to do in a state like South Carolina. You see very similar stories in states like Mississippi, where, black voters make up 40% of the population, but then white voters vote 90 to 10 for the Republican Party. So that is why South Carolina will be a likely margin. It could be closer. It will be closer, but, Lindsey Graham is still going to be able to win very easily. So then the likely margin states for the Democrats, I do believe first the state of Arizona is a likely margin. Mark Kelly is a very good candidate. He's done very well in the fundraising, very well in the polls. Martha McSally is not a good candidate. She's not even really an incumbent because she wasn't even elected to this seat. She's going in a state that is trending towards the Democrats as well. So, she's not doing too well right now. She didn't do too well in the debates either. Mark Kelly's a popular figure, Martha McSally's not, and just everything is going against Martha McSally in this seat, and I do think that she will lose by a likely margin because of it. John Hickenlooper, I also do expect to win by a likely margin in Colorado. This is where you have Colorado versus, you have John Hickenlooper, the former governor of Colorado, versus Cory Gardner, who's the incumbent senator. He was elected by kind of a fluke in 2014 in Colorado, and it's not looking like he has any chance of winning again, especially when he, came out in support of Amy Coney Barrett. He also, voted to gut the ACA, things like that. Colorado's a blue state now, not like it, it was closer back in the day, but it's not close anymore, and John Hickenlooper will be able to win easily. I also do think Minnesota is a likely margin state. You know, Minnesota's a state where you have Tina Smith running, who's doing, you know, very well in fundraising against Jason Lewis, and she's done very well in the polls, with the exception of like one poll that showed it at around 3 percentage points. But other than that, she's done very well in the polls, and she can gain enough in the Minneapolis suburbs to be able to win by quite an easy margin, which I do expect her to do. And so after the likely margin states, Democrats are at 47 seats, Republicans are at 46 seats. Now getting into the lean margin states, first, I do believe both Georgia seats are actually lean. Now, John Ossoff isn't as good of a candidate as people have made him out to be. He's done quite bad, you know, not bad, but he's hasn't done that well in the polls, especially considering that Joe Biden is actually leading in many polls. And David Perdue's not that great of a candidate either. You know, John Ossoff's done well in fundraising and the trends are in his favor, but he's just not good enough of a candidate to be able to win. And Georgia's normal election is lean Republican. Now, Georgia's special is really weird putting a rating for it, because for the general election, I do expect Warnock to actually come first, because you've got Loeffler and Collins, which are basically splitting the whole Republican vote, and then you've got Warnock, who's kind of shot up after the endorsement by Barack Obama. He's shot up over Matt Lieberman in the state. So I do expect Warnock to come first in the general election, and then probably Loeffler is going to come second. But in the runoff, I do expect Loeffler to win by a lean margin, because Loeffler will be better in the Georgia suburbs, which is the area that is trending towards the Democrats. Now, those are actually... Montana is another state that I do think is lean Republican. You know, you have Steve Bullock here, who's a pretty good candidate. You know, he's the incoming governor of the state of Montana, and Steve Daines isn't that great of a candidate. You know, he's the only Republican senator to be elected by Montana in the last six elections. So, you know, Montana has elected Democrats before. They did as recently as 2018 when they re-elected John Tester. And, you know, he voted against Brett Kavanaugh. He voted against both of Trump's judges, and he had a pretty strong voting record with the Democrats, but he still won in Montana. And, you know, you'd think that on paper, Steve Bullock would be a very good candidate, but he hasn't done too well in the polls recently. We had an Emerson poll. He was down like 7. You know, I wouldn't necessarily trust that, you know, it's only one poll, but, you know, it's a very interesting state. I do think it will be lean Republican, probably by around 4 percentage points. But, you know, that's another opportunity Democrats do have. Now, lean margin states for the Democrats. First, I do believe Michigan is lean margin state. I did have this as likely Democrat before, but, you know, I do think it'll be a little bit closer. The New York Times poll had it as Gary Peters plus one. He just doesn't have the name recognition that he needs. And that is, you know, not that good for him, because he's running against John James, who, you know, unlike most other Republicans this cycle, is doing well in the fundraising. And so I do expect John James to do quite well. I do expect, you know, Gary Peters to still be able to win by around 4 percentage points, but it will be a little closer, and I do think that Gary Peters will be able to pull it off in the end. Maine is another state I do think is lean Democrat at this point. There are virtually no metrics that show Susan Collins is in a good position. The recent fundraising numbers show that Sarah Gideon virtually outraced Collins by like $33 million, and, you know, Maine is not an expensive ad buying market, so she, you know, Sarah Gideon can virtually blow through all this money, and, you know, it's in a, you know, cheap ad market, which is Maine. So she's a good candidate. She's doing well in the polls against Susan Collins, and the ranked choice voting will also help her, because you have Lisa Savage of the Green Party, and, you know, some will vote for the third party for their second choice, but of the people who are voting for Collins or Gideon as the third party second choice, they overwhelmingly break to Sarah Gideon, which will marginally help her, but that could be very crucial in the state of Maine. You know, the state is much more polarized now. Joe Biden's expected to win the state, I think, by a safe margin. I think he could even win the Maine 2nd District. You've got Jared Golden in Maine 2nd District, who's going to win by a safe margin. Same thing for the Democratic congresswoman in the 1st District. So, not many metrics going well for Susan Collins there, and I do think she will lose her seat by a lean margin. And then the final two seats. First, I do believe North Carolina is still Democrat in the Democrat column. I do think it is tilt Democrat. You know, the scandal did kind of hurt Cal Cunningham. We've had one poll. We had the Emerson poll, which went from like Cunningham plus 6 or something to Cunningham plus 1. So that's kind of worrying for Cunningham. But then we had some polls like PPP went from Cunningham plus 4 to Cunningham plus 6. We also had another poll. I think it was Monmouth, actually. Monmouth went from around Cunningham plus 1 to Cunningham plus 4, so that's another good thing for Cal Cunningham. He's also doing very well in the fundraising. Tom Tillis is still an unpopular figure, and the scandal doesn't seem to have hurt Cal Cunningham that much, and the thing is that he was, you know, up by a good decent amount already, that even if he is hurt by a scandal, he will still be able to win, which I do expect him to be able to narrowly win at this point. Democrats are already at 50 seats, and I do believe their 51st seat will be the state of Iowa. Now, the state of Iowa has actually been very interesting. It's gotten a lot closer lately, and I do think that Reese Greenfield's been doing very well. You know, he had a Des Moines Register poll, which is a couple weeks old by now, but, you know, they are the gold standard poll of Iowa. I keep mentioning it, but, you know, I've calculated all of the polls it did, president, senate, governor, Democratic primary, and they have an average error of 2 percentage points, and on a partisan basis, they have virtually, you know, it's like a 1.5 Democrat bias, so... And Greenfield was up 3 points in that poll. We've also had a New York Times poll which showed her up. You know, we had multiple polls that showed Teresa Greenfield up. She also got $28 million in fundraising to Joni Ernst's just $7 million. You know, we saw the debate moment last night, which is also a not a good moment for Joni Ernst. So Joni Ernst is not that popular of a figure in Iowa. She's not that great of a candidate. And Teresa Greenfield has turned out to be a much better candidate than most people, even I, assumed at first. And I do believe this seat has, you know, gone dramatically towards the Democrats' column at this point, but it still will be very close. But I do expect Democrats to narrowly win it at this point. So overall, I do expect Democrats to get 51 seats in the Senate, which would be a net gain of 4. They would flip 5 seats, Maine, North Carolina, Iowa, Colorado, Arizona. Republicans would flip the state of Alabama. And, you know, Democrats would retake the Senate majority at this point. I also think Joe Biden is going to win, and Democrats will have the House, which would mean there would be a Democratic trifecta with a small and slim 51-49 seat majority in the Senate. So thank you all for watching this video. Please like this video and subscribe to the channel. Also, join the Discord that is linked down in the description, and check out the website, which is also linked down in the description. But again, guys, thank you all for watching this video, and I will see you guys later.